40 years ago, the world was introduced to the raw sound of the Ramones' debut album. Few recognized at the time that it would go on to become a founding document of punk rock. To celebrate the anniversary, the Grammy Museum is pleased, as you know, to open the exhibit, Hey Ho, Let's Go, Ramones and the Birth of Punk. To help kick off the exhibit, we've put together a terrific panel of guests, and I do mean terrific panel of guests, to discuss their personal connections to the band, the band's beginnings, and ultimately their place in rock and roll history. First, allow me to introduce a man who saw every one, get this, every one of the 2,263 Ramones shows. Got your name right on it there. Next, a writer and musician in his own right and the brother of Joey Ramone. Please welcome Mickey Leigh. Our next guest has recorded and produced a bunch of artists as diverse as Talking Heads, Peter Wolf, Mick Jagger, Joan Jett, Marshall Crenshaw, The Smithereens, The Motorhead. We could go on and on. More importantly, he was the engineer or producer on 6 different Ramones albums. Give it up for Ed Stasium. Next, the man who's responsible for exposing the Ramones to the wider world. He gave them a record deal and a platform to release their debut, the legendary founder of Sire Records, Seymour Stein. And finally, a woman whose inspiration and support helped make the exhibit possible, the wife of Johnny Ramone. Please welcome Linda Ramone.
Scott, before we get started on the proceedings, I think there's something really important
please,
to say.
Ahead.
First two guys I've known since I'm 10 years old, so I want to give a salute to the drill sergeant, Johnny Ramone. Right? Hey ho, let's go to Tommy Ramone.
Yeah.
A big pat on the back to Dee Dee Ramone. To the somebody who put something in my drink, cheers to Richie Ramone. glad to see you to CJ Ramone. A crown to the king of the road, Marky Ramone, because he just keeps going and going and going and going. and a thank you very much to Elvis Ramone. To a swing and a hit to the sire of SWAT rock, Sir Seymour Stein.
There you go.
We gotta go to the namesake of the song, Danny Says Fields. Credits to Craig Leon, producer of the first Ramone, A nod of the head to Mr. Ed Stasium. Let's see.
Okay, are we ready to go here?
Yeah, I just want to say also one more thing.
One more thing.
To the first guy I saw when I first opened my eyes, to my big brother Joey Ramone. Right on, motherfucker.
Right on. Right on. Okay.
Thank you.
So I want to start. And by the way, thank you all for being here.
Thank you.
I hope you enjoyed the exhibit out there. We could not do this and give some perspective to it without your participation, so we appreciate that. But I want to start with Linda, and I'm particularly interested in, there was a whole community around CBGB when the Ramones started and were playing there. Tell me about your experience with the community there, the other bands, and what you saw when you first saw the Ramones.
Well, I started going into the city with my friend Justin, who was in this band called Milk and Cookies, and he started opening up for the Ramones. So I saw the Ramones very early on, the first stage, when Johnny was on the other side. So it was very, and you sat at tables. And you'd go into the city each weekend, and one weekend you could see the Ramones, you could see Blondie, you could see Talking Heads, and then later on you'd see the Dead Boys and the Cramps and Suicide. So every weekend, then you'd see Patti Smith and Television. It was just amazing, and the two favorite bands of mine, of course, were the Ramones and the Heartbreakers. So Johnny Thunders, who was in the New York Dolls, and who I had seen very at the tippy-tippy end at Club 82, but the Dolls were kind of over. Like, they were all, like, on drugs. They'd come out at 3 o'clock in the morning, and so nobody would be left.
Hold on. A round of applause for drugs?
For drugs, I guess. But it actually ruined their career. And then the Heartbreakers. So everybody just kind of hung out together, and everybody was friends. And I had my friend Janice, who wrote this column called Press Lips. And it was in the New York Rocker, some underground newspaper. But she started writing it, and Johnny at the time, you know, was doing not so good things, bad things. And she'd write it in it, so he'd have to go in Forest Hills, where he lived with his first wife, and go buy up all the New York Rockers so she wouldn't see it. And Janice carried this like a weight, and if she didn't mention you in her column, you were insulted and you felt you were nobody. But if she did mention you, she basically insulted a lot. Like, she called Lux from the Cramps, he had a head like a bread box.
But tell me about, so the first time, I love that, I'm waiting for somebody to say that about me.
So tell me
about the first time you saw the Ramones and your reaction.
Well, it went by really quick. I think they did like 5 songs. You blink and they were gone. And all you kind of remember is Johnny yelling. That's all I remember, and that's what I remembered for the rest of my life, Johnny yelling. from day one to the last day, Johnny was always saying something and commanding somebody to do something.
Right.
Because he was the commander-in-chief.
Right, yes.
And
yes.
He sent himself to military school. It's not like his parents sent him.
Yeah. I wanna go to Monte because Monte has had the privilege, I suppose, of being with the band every one of their their shows.
I missed a few.
I was there for the very beginning, actually.
I'm sure you were.
About 2,500.
I'm going to get to that in a minute.
Just to set the record of course,
absolutely. But I know you grew up with Tommy.
Yes, I did. I went to junior high school with Tommy. High school with Tommy.
Yeah. So
I was in bands with Tommy also way before the Ramones.
Sure, yeah. Sure. Tell me about the first time you saw the Ramones and what you heard.
They were very, very worse. A 3-piece group at the time. Tommy and I were managing, and we built a rehearsal studio called Performance Studios on 20th Street in Manhattan. Yeah, 20th Street.
That was either for the studio or the street.
We built the place and we managed the place, and we got time for our own projects. I had groups at the time, and he had groups at the time. But one of the groups, he was just going to manage them and produce them, was the Ramones. It was a 3-piece group at the time. It was Joey on drums, Johnny on guitar, and Dee Dee singing and playing bass. That was very, very raw. But Tommy saw that Dee Dee was having a lot of trouble singing and playing bass, so he pulled Joey off the drums. He had a great voice, and then they started looking for drummers. Now, Tommy really didn't want to be in the group at the time. He just wanted to produce them. They couldn't find anybody. They were so raw that nobody could really understand what they were doing at the time. So he sat in, and finally he just joined the group because nobody could understand what they were doing in the beginning.
Right, right. So
it was very raw, very, very raw.
Yeah. So Mickey, talk about, you know, the first time that you saw the band with your brother as the lead singer.
Well, he had been a drummer, as you said, but
yeah,
he sang in one band before joining the Ramones, a glam band called Sniper.
Yes.
And that was the first time I saw him being the lead singer of a band. But I saw him being a Ramone before there were Ramones, because I had an acoustic guitar. He asked me if I could teach him how to play, right? So he's a lefty, I'm a righty. I had to figure out a way to teach him how to play without changing the strings around every time. So I saw Richie Havens on TV playing
with upside down and backwards.
One finger.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
So I thought maybe if I taught my brother how to play just on the bottom two strings, the E and the A, it might be enough, right? So I thought he was really into Alice Cooper. He'd play I'm 18 like 20 times a day. So I showed him how to play the chords to I'm 18. 2 days later, he's playing those same chords, but singing I Don't Care over him. And this is a year or two before there were Ramones.
Yeah.
Then he wrote a song called with the same chords, Here Today, Gone Tomorrow. So those became, I think, the first Ramones songs ever written.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I was also in bands with John and Tommy and when I was a kid. And the first time I saw them was they were rehearsing in my mother had an art gallery, and we would rehearse in the basement. So one day I go in there and I hear the sound, this rumble coming up from the basement. I open the door, and there it was. You know, like Monty says, as raw as it could be, but it was the beginning. You know, so that was the first time I saw the Ramones. Tommy wasn't even in the band yet. My brother was playing the drums, and as legend goes, he took so long to set up his drums, they couldn't wait. So he would sit on the point of the drum seat without the stool on top. And I guess I was uncomfortable.
Yeah.
So
they
found somebody
so.
who could set up their drums a little quicker.
Right. So Seymour, tell me about when the Ramones became aware of the Ramones and how you became aware of the Ramones.
I became aware of them. First, I was aware of CBGBs before that. And I think that a lot of credit for all of this it belongs to Hilly Kristal. I really, really do. I mean, CBGB stands for Country, Bluegrass, and Blues, which is what the music he loved. But he let the doors open to anyone and everyone, and it was through his generosity that bands like the Ramones and Talking Heads and Television and many, many a Blondie and many, many others were able to get their start. And what was your question?
Yeah, yeah. The first time you became aware of the Ramones.
I became aware of them for word of mouth. Danny Fields, Lisa Lisa Robinson, people like that. And I always wanted to go see them, but I was spending a lot of time in England at that time, signing up some English bands. And I finally got back in time to see one of their bands, but I was sick as a dog and I couldn't go. I sent my wife to see them with Danny, and Linda came back raving. So a day or two later, I rented a studio for an hour. And they played about, I would say, 18, maybe I'm exaggerating, 15 songs in 25 minutes. I mean, like that. So we spent the rest of the time, because they wanted, as badly as I wanted to see them after hearing those songs, and I think they wanted the deal even more than I did. And Johnny especially, he said, we want to go in the studio this week, you know? And all that. I said, fine, you know, but you got to see a lawyer. And I made them an offer, and you know, and the rest is pretty much history.
Yeah. So which brings me to Ed and Ed Stasium, who produced, engineered a bunch of Ramones records. But I want to talk about the band in the studio. You know, much has been made about recording the first record, and Craig Leon has talked about how these guys had. Because Craig Leon, who went on to work with like Pavarotti and you know, serious classical people, you know, the finest of equipment and mics and all this kind of stuff, and he has said they had the best of equipment, and it was not at all that their efforts in the studio were sloppy. That's not what they were, but they did have a certain ethos about how they would go about working in the studio. And I'm wondering if you would talk a little bit about working with them and kind of the process.
It was fast. Yeah, really fast.
Yeah.
I actually was living in Montreal at the time that I ran into Tony Bon Jovi, who actually co-produced with Tommy, Leave Home. I was late for the session because my daughter was born. So I came in the second day, and actually Bob Clearmountain set up the session at Sundragon Studios, a little tiny dead room on 21st Street. Remember Sundragon, Seymour?
Yeah,
a little tiny place.
And I remember with Johnny, if he didn't do at least 7 tracks the first night, there would be hell to pay.
Oh my God. Yeah. So they had already done 3, and then we did the rest of them the next day. We finished them up, basically. Did that, drums were done, no editing, they're all straight through takes on Leave Home.
Right.
As we progressed, it got a little longer, but on Leave Home, we did those tracks in 2 days, basically. And then on one day, we double tracked it, then we started doing Joey's vocal on the third and fourth day, and it was done in a minuscule amount of time.
Yeah. I'm wondering, and Seymour, you might be able to comment on this as well. How did they, or did they take advice, direction, suggestions about songs, about sounds, about working in the studio? Were they open to your ideas, or?
I'm not a producer. You know, I'm a song man, and they did play me the songs before they, you know, they recorded them. And I'm not a producer.
Yeah.
I loved most of them, you know, and some people think, you know, there was a lot of similarity to the songs, but every one of them were different than each other, and I think that a lot of originality and, a lot of greatness there.
So there was one conflict, if you remember, during the recording of the first album, where there was a bit of a dispute about the lyrics to Today Your Love, Tomorrow the World.
Right.
Because they had the a black humor approach to Nazism, and it was a bit of a dispute. Maybe Seymour.
I was a little concerned about Blitzkrieg Bop. You know those lyrics. You know, maybe the fact that I'm Jewish had something to do with it. But the thing is, if I had to pick a favorite song, it would be very difficult. But I think it would be Blitzkrieg Bop. I just love it so much.
Yeah. Yeah.
Getting back to the studio, they were well rehearsed before they got into the studio. I didn't attend rehearsals for Leave Home, Rocket to Russia, Road to Ruin. I started attending rehearsals and working with the band slightly on End of the Century. But it was the first three albums I worked on, they were ready to go, raring to go.
Yeah.
And the same thing happened with Rocket to Russia. Went into Media Sound, a larger room, so there was a bit of a larger drum sound on that record. But it was just quick. It was fast. Road to Ruin, we spent a bit of time on. Tommy and I, the band wanted to, you know, try to break through a little bit more, so we experimented a lot on that one. But Leave Home and Rocket to Russia were boom, 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 knock it out.
Yeah. So Billy, you're in the UK. The Sex Pistols, you know, are happening, and here come the Ramones. Tell me about the first time you heard the Ramones and what you thought when you heard them.
Yeah, well, we were watching everything that came out of New York and obviously everything that came out of CBGB's. But yeah, hearing that first album, I mean, It was like the effect was like a tidal wave in terms of how it affected the people who were coming up with the music in England, very much into the punk scene. I think practically every band that I can think of fastened their music up triple speed. Yeah. The only group I think who didn't was the Sex Pistols, because they'd already made records and they had a mid-pace kind of lope to their music. And really the Ramones album was just like this. It was like, whoa, what the fuck? This is like, yeah. You know, it's the album. Whoa, this is what we're, this is the way. It was like the blueprint. This is the way. This is what's going to do it. This is where we're going to knock everybody. Because we were looking for something so desperate. You know, we were disenfranchised youth on the scrap heap. That's what they were telling us. And there was a band telling us, fuck you. Fuck them. Don't listen to them. You can rock.
Yeah. Yeah. Go.
We can live. Life goes on.
I remember, you know, the Sire band, the Flaming Groovies, got an offer to play in England, and great band, Shake Some Action, and they welcomed the Ramones as their opening act, and I mean everyone was there, the Sex Pistols, the Clash, the Damned, I mean everyone turned up, and later I found out. That Nigel Granger's brother, Lucian, he was about 13 years old, he was at that gig, and that's what made him want to go into the music business, so which is a pity that he ever did. But but I mean, that was really a turning point in British
yeah.
music.
Yeah. Well, and one of the things that the Ramones did not necessarily subscribe to, you know, when punk became when it came over to the U.S. and there was all of this Sturm und Drang about the violence and the spitting and all this kind of stuff. They did not sign up to that. Linda, talk a little bit about Johnny's
really
sense
crazy.
Of that.
Oh, the spitting thing drove Johnny insane. I mean, he's a clean freak. First of all, he would blow dry his hair every day perfectly, look perfectly. When he would leave to go on tour, he would fold his own T-shirts exactly like he was in military school. Yeah. Joey, on the other hand, did not. And he got stuck right in the middle. So as everyone was spitting at that time, it was really, they would like gob from like, and so Johnny and Dee Dee would stand back and Joey would be coving.
Oh.
And then the enemy came out because Johnny complained to some writer about the spitting. Goes, oh, the Ramones don't want to be spit on. No. And it's like, no, go. It was disgusting.
Go. It was really horrible.
Linda, you know, who you should have mentioned as well as one of the early pioneers with the Ramones, my wife. Linda said, look, this band don't want to, they're not going to do this tour with the Clash and the Sex Pistols because they don't want to be spit on. So you're going to have to take the blame, which I did. They hated me. You know, the managers of both of those bands. But I gladly did it because she said, look, they take 3 showers a day. Is that true?
No, not really.
Yeah,
but not all of them.
Actually.
Monty, who was with the band on all
really
these tours,
extremely bad there at the time. I put him on stage, and luckily I could stand on the side of the stage, not on stage, and it was raining down, and they had us play the whole set. This is for a while. This happened. And then it tapered off after a while, and Johnny would see somebody spitting, get that guy out of there, get that guy out of there. But when it was going on, it was really unbelievably horrible. Yeah. I don't know what the honor is to spit on a band is. Anybody know?
I don't know, I was there, English people.
Wow. And then their jackets.
Hold on, I'll tell you one thing. You're in trouble if they didn't spit on you, because they didn't like you.
I mean, they come off stage.
I guess it went both ways.
The first trip to England, the Roundhouse shows on July 4th, 1976.
Yeah.
I was the only person that they could take with them. It was the stage manager. And when the gob started pouring down, we didn't know what the hell it was all about, you know?
Were they aware that, that something like that could happen?
No.
That was very early on.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
1976, the first shows, we went to Seymour's house. Danny Fields took us to Seymour's house, and Seymour and Linda were in bed, naked.
Oh, well.
I was not, I should hope so.
Mandy's here.
I'm not sure we were ready for that, Mickey, but thank you.
Yes, and Mandy's here.
I wasn't used to seeing a record company executives in bed. No, not yet. But no, they didn't. And the next night at Dingwalls, it was a closer, tighter audience.
Right.
And everybody was just covered with phlegm. It was coming from the back of the room, like in a graceful arc.
Jackets were soaked.
Landing on the cymbals and dangling.
Horrible. Yeah.
The guy would dangle from the cymbals and.
I mean, here's what I do know. I mean, a few years later, you know, very famously, Los Lobos opened a show for the Sex Pistols at the Olympic Auditorium here in Los Angeles. And literally, those guys, this is how many years? 40 years later, are still talking about the emotional effect that that show had of people spitting at them and throwing stuff at them. And I mean, they literally still talk about it. So... That said, I want to get to Shepard, because you know of all of the distinguished guests we have here, you're coming at this from somewhat of a different perspective. So tell me about the effect the Ramones had on you.
Well, I grew up in South Carolina, and you know it's a cultural desert, you know, it's a wasteland.
Apologies to anybody from South Carolina.
I got into skateboarding and that kind of came with punk rock, and that was at the end of 1983. And Jonesy's here. One of the first records I was introduced to was Nevermind the Bollocks, Here's the Sex Pistols. And then shortly after that, when I talked about, you know, I like punk rock, people said, well, then you must love the Ramones. I said, no, I haven't heard them. So I was handed the first Ramones record, and I took to it instantly because. I mean, it's one of the most infectious records ever made, and it's perfect front to back. And the way they look on the cover, you know, to me, even though it was years after that was, you know, kind of a breaking through dangerous look. If you were in L.A. or New York, for South Carolina, it was still quite hostile to most people.
Yeah.
And so, you know, and I had seen the shirts with the presidential seal, and you know that had an irreverent allure. But I mean, it made a tremendous impact on me. Uh-huh. And when I did the first record, I've done three record packages for Billy. But when we first met, and I heard some of the music from his management, and decided like, okay, I got to take some stuff in there that I think is good inspiration. Do you remember what records I brought?
Yeah, the first Ramones album.
Ah.
Yeah, and the first Clash record. Those were the two covers that I said these have something to them that. That ought to be what you're going for.
Did you have a chance? I mean, Arturo Vega is you know the guy who designed, and he deserves a round of applause. Did you get a chance to spend some time with him and kind of get a sense of his ethos around working with these guys?
Yeah, I did. We had a few mutual friends in New York, and I met him in maybe 2003. And he ended up coming to a few of my art shows, and he was always incredibly kind and humble. I felt like I'm not worthy, but he was really cool. And to me, he didn't he didn't have an ego about what he'd done. It was and hearing about all this, I've read a lot about the Ramones, and hearing about all the stuff that went down at his loft, and mm-hmm. right around the corner from CBGB's, et cetera. To me, it's just a really inspiring. It's an inspiring story of the whole group, but also that visual component, because that's what I do. That the Ramones have such a strong image with their logo and the Gabba Gabba Hey, and working with John Holstrom on. From Punk Magazine on Back a Rocket to Russia, right. and et cetera. They had a really great aesthetic in general.
And Linda, we should talk about that a little bit. I mean, clearly the band, beyond the music, they had a sense of how they wanted to present themselves. They were very clear about that. Talk a little bit about, you know, whatever Johnny may have told you over time about the presentation.
Well, Tommy convinced Johnny that glitter rock was on its way out and that people in middle America were not going to be able to wear spandex because any guy who was 5 pounds overweight wouldn't look good in it. So Johnny decided, and Johnny was a construction worker at that point, and he would wear construction boots, jeans, and a leather jacket. So Johnny was going to wear his work outfit now out. And that's what happened. And then they put a t-shirt on. But Tommy was always like the mastermind of putting everything together. He convinced Johnny to be in a band with Dee Dee. And Johnny would be like, no, I don't want to. And he'd go, no, you two would look good together. You're going to be great together. You're great. So Tommy was really, he was great with all that. Yeah. So the whole look was really because glitter rock was going out and they started the whole look. And punk, to this day, everybody wears ripped jeans, everybody wears a leather jacket, It's pretty amazing, except nobody cut their jeans to look ripped. They actually were ripped, and they wore them. And unfortunately, we don't have a lot of those jeans because they wore them till they ripped and threw them away.
Yeah. So, Billy, you know, the one thing that's been mentioned here consistently is the Ramones songs were short, fast and short. And I'm wondering, as you first heard them, how did their song construction affect you as a young artist writing songs?
Well, I think it showed us all that, you know, simplicity isn't necessarily devoid of content, really. And that's what was fantastic about them. They were packing in a ton of content into the smallest space possible. And that said everything to us who were kind of coming from, you know, the sort of prog rock era where it was so bloated and overblown. And then you had a group saying all in 0 minutes. It just was the most greatest thing in the world.
Yeah.
It's what we needed. We needed that brevity. We needed brevity to say something and be to the point.
Yes, and then you did Ready, Steady, Go. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, so we very much sort of, really sort of tried to use similar things in our own music.
Sure.
Trying to have our own vibe, though, not try and necessarily copy exactly what they were doing. But at the same time, we were so influenced, we couldn't help but follow along in their path. I mean, in England, I think this became a uniform for most punk rockers in England, except maybe they'd have spiky hair. That was the difference, you know. But that I can remember everybody in England looking like that.
They were so huge
in England. They were massive. They had a number one song with Sheena as a punk rocker. So they were huge in England.
Yeah. I'm wondering. Actually, they probably had earlier success in the UK than they had here.
Yeah, massive.
Absolutely. Yeah. Sadly, and absolutely.
Yeah.
And in places like Brazil and Argentina, and they were superstars.
Yeah. Ed, tell me a little bit about, we're talking about, you know, these songs, but they were short and fast and trying to capture that on record. Did they stress at all about being, you know, getting their sound right?
Never. No, we put up the microphones and record it. And that's my ethic. Yeah. You know, I'm a rock and roll producer.
Not during End of Century, though. That was a little different.
That's a whole other story.
Go with that. Go with that. End of the Century. Go with that.
I don't know where to start.
I was there every day. We could start from the beginning.
Yeah. One thing we did go. I did say that we did rehearse during that period. We went to SIR. I flew in a few days earlier. We did like 3 days of rehearsals. We had done demos, and we put together a little studio in Seymour's basement on 73rd Street. In the 74th. It's a long time ago. I'm glad you remembered.
You were close.
Yeah, I was close.
I'm glad.
Yeah, 74th Street. We did the demos for End of the Century down there. Then we rehearsed some more at SIR. And on the third day, Phil's coming in. And we never spoke to Phil. Phil would always have his assistant Donna call me. I was at the Sunset. I was at the Sunset Marquee, and she would say, "Phil is going to call you in 15 minutes." And then Phil would call me up, say, "Ed, I'm going to come to rehearsal today. I'm coming at 6:00." Comes to rehearsal the first day, and comes down with a briefcase and his bodyguard, George. Was George?
Yeah, it was George. Yeah. George.
I can tell you stories about George.
Yes.
Tell us a story about George.
Well, Phil, I used to go over to Phil's house a lot, and he would always lock me in.
Yes. Yes. I was locked in.
What?
I was locked in.
He would always
locked
to his house.
Yes.
I was locked in.
Listen,
How many other people were locked into Phil Spector's house?
But
I think Clem was locked in.
Yeah. I love Phil Spector, and I feel very badly that he's locked up because I don't believe he could kill that woman. But that's just my opinion. But he did lock me up every time I went there, and I had. He said, "I got to see you." He said, I said, "Look, I can't come over tonight. I have an important meeting with Mo Austin tomorrow, and I know you're going to lock me in the house." So he said, "I'll meet you outside the house, and I'll give you the key." And I tried the key, and it worked. And then I get up to leave like 2 or 3 hours later, and his bodyguard George is laying on in front of the door, like he's pretending that he's drunk. And he can't budget. He was a big guy. I said, "Look, I'm going to kick him in the head if you don't." Then all of a sudden, George jumped up, and I ran out of the house. But I got to him. You know, I think the Paley brothers are here who were recording at the same time with Phil in the studio. And I think they were pretty happy with it. But I know that Johnny wasn't. Johnny, can I just tell a quick story about Johnny?
Please.
Johnny's father died during the recording. Do you remember that? I called Johnny up to offer my condolences. He says, "Well, you know," he said, "I feel pretty bad about it." He says, "But at least it's my ticket out of here." And
he was going to quit, and it sure was.
I mean, he never came back, did he?
He came back.
He did come back. But he was about to quit.
Yeah.
After the infamous Rock and Roll High School introduction that we must have played over and over again. You know, Johnny always says it was 10 hours, but it was probably like 2. Maybe 3 hours.
It felt like 20.
It did. It felt like 20 just playing that. For that record, I was in the studio with the band, playing with the band.
Yeah.
So we would hit that first chord. Blang! We'd get our feedback. I'd be playing through Johnny's... that practice amp that Johnny had? Mike Matthews' Freedom Amp. And Johnny had his Marshalls. And we played that thing over and over and over again and didn't know what they were doing in the control room. He's talking to Larry. And it just goes over and over. And Johnny was ready to quit that day. And you spoke to, I had to call you because Johnny was going to quit. Yeah. And I had to have a conference meeting.
I made several calls to him. Mm-hmm. But, look, Phil... This was Phil's style of recording with everyone. It was
over and over again.
He was a perfectionist, and I think he's a genius. I mean,
absolutely.
And I haven't known many geniuses, and I feel very sad for what's happened to him. But
that's what drove the Ramones crazy because everything they did was fast.
Yeah.
And coming in with Phil Spector,
right?
It was slow, sure. And it was driving
over and over again. And he would listen to the playback
crazy.
At excruciating levels, painful levels.
Phil really only liked Joey. He loved Joey. And when we went to Phil's house, he would sing to Joey on the piano, "I love you, Joey, you're so tall."
Right. That's right.
And Johnny would sit there, and Dee Dee would sit there, and everybody would be complaining because all Phil really cared about was Joey.
This is really good now. This is great.
But this was...
And that's the truth.
The reason I try to make it happen was because for Joey... This was a dream come true.
And it was.
Working with Phil, yes.
Mm-hmm. If he could have one wish in life, that was it. You must know that too. Yeah. I mean,
it was a thrill for me.
What did Joey tell you about working with Phil?
The first time we met Phil was our second time we went out to Los Angeles.
At the whiskey.
Yeah. And, I was carrying the guitars up and there's this guy in a black cape. sort of short guy looking up, talking to Joey, and they were deeply involved in the conversation, And after Phil left, Joey said to me, "Wow, you know, that was Phil Spector. He was practically speechless, you know." And he said,
"So Joey did get his single."
He said he really wants to. He really loves my voice. I think he just really wants to work with me.
That was around the first record.
Yeah, there's a picture of him in one of my photos of Phil. You're going to get a look at what he looked like back then. And,
yeah.
And one of the photos stuff in the back there. Take a look.
Mm-hmm. Joey just kind of laughed, you know, about the fact that Phil really didn't really so much care about the band, but really wanted to make a Joey.
Work with Joey. Ramone. Yeah. Yeah,
so you know, he got along with Marky. He also got along with Marky very well because Marky was drinking at the time, and they were drinking buddies during that.
They're pals.
So
Phil would bring in cocktails for me as well. I brought in one of those little canned cocktails.
Manischewitz?
No, it wasn't. Phil was drinking the Manischewitz. He had a little cooler.
Phil was drinking Manischewitz?
Yes, he was. Yes. Yes.
Phil Spector drinking Manischewitz?
The cheapest wine you could get. I mean, it didn't matter if it was Manischewitz or kosher or not. He'd drink the cheapest wine because he just wanted to get gaga, you know.
Okay. Mind blown. Phil Spector, Manischewitz.
He drank it out of a cane, right? Out of a cane, he would drink it.
I don't remember that.
Yeah. I saw him drinking out of Dixie cups.
Freshka.
Yes.
Remember the Freshka can?
Yes.
I went to go take a sip out of his Freshka can one day, and he goes, "No, Linda." And I go, "Why?" He goes, "You won't like what's in it." And I was like, "Oh." So he spiked his Freshka too.
So tell me. Go ahead.
We did take after take.
Yeah.
And, you know, listened to dozens and dozens of times back at excruciating levels, really loud. And you couldn't talk to each other. And Larry Levine, I didn't engineer this record. Larry Levine was the engineer, you know, the great Larry Levine, who did all of Phil's records. Who also won a Grammy for Herb Alpert's A Taste of Honey for Best Engineer Recording.
They gave him a heart attack.
Yeah, gave him a heart attack during the mixing. But Larry and Phil had a system of sign language. You know, Phil would stand behind Larry and would hit Larry on the back and go, vocal up, snare up. No words were saying. If you want it reverb on something, a little bit more reverb, Phil would slap his tongue. Not Larry's tongue, but Phil would slap his own tongue. He'd go, on the vocal. And Larry would crank the reverb up, but you couldn't hear in there, and he wouldn't stop playback. It just kept on going and going and going. And he would stomp his feet and swear a little bit.
You know what he say.
Yeah.
You know what he say.
Yeah, Ed does a good thing. Go do it. Come on.
Watch the film. End of the Century. You'll see my Phil imitation.
When End of the Century was done, what did the band say about their record?
Joey loved it.
Johnny hated it.
Marky
liked it. Dee Dee was indifferent.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Talk about being like Dan. He locked us into the studio once. They had
Welcome
enough.
To the club.
Locked you in the studio.
Yeah. They had enough one day. They wanted to go, so they all got up. And he had his bodyguard stand by the door and said, "No, you're not getting out of here."
Yes.
And he came up to me and says, give me the keys to the van." He started yelling at me. Finally, we got out of there. We talked him out, but he didn't want us to leave. And he actually stopped, you know, blocked the door.
Yeah, I want to talk a little bit. I mean, we could go on about Phil Spector, but I want to talk about the Ramones on the road live performance, because you know their impact was so great in terms of being in front of audiences. And I'm wondering, Monty, being the person who was with them for every one of their shows.
Not everyone. About 2,580 something. I don't know. Enough.
Okay.
Enough.
Okay. A great preponderance. Let's put it that way. Is there a show or a tour that in your mind was most emblematic
No. They're all different. I mean, there's so many shows that you really can't. I can't specifically pick out one time.
Right.
Because over the years, there's different people in the bands and different.
Sure.
So it's all different feels and different type of tours.
Sure.
But I can say one thing about that, but the show at the Rainbow on New Year's Eve that Generation X opened up for the Ramones.
Uh-huh.
That was a great show.
Was just an amazing show.
Yeah.
The performance we recorded.
Remember that, Billy?
It's a long time ago. Yes, I can remember.
I was kidding.
I still have my Generation X t-shirt from that night.
The shows that I hear the most feedback from in my travels are those in the north of England and in Scotland, in Manchester, they love to play in Scotland because there's that theater that had where the stage was like 20 feet off the ground.
Yeah,
and also Newcastle. And the audience. I meet people, and that's all they talk about was seeing the Ramones. You know, I'm talking about 3 or 4 years ago, as recent as that. You know.
I think it was like a landmark.
Barrowlands
in Scotland. Glasgow, you're talking about?
Glasgow, yes.
Yeah, Barrowlands. That's where
the theater was high, 20 feet off the
ground. Yeah,
off
high stage.
But that's what I thought, the Apollo. Go.
Possibly the Apollo, maybe?
Yeah.
I remember that had a high stage, I think. Yeah,
the most pivotal show had to be the one at the Roundhouse on July 4th. They were playing for 300 people in the States.
Yes.
And they go to
the UK, right?
3,000 people.
Yeah. So. Billy, did you see them in the UK early on?
I saw them at the Roundhouse.
Oh, you did?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Of course we did. It was like New York was the mecca of punk to us, so of course we were going to see anything that we could. And we were there on that first, I think that was the first time they played in London, wasn't it?
July 4th, 1976.
Yeah.
With the Stranglers.
And that's right. It was incredible.
Shepard, talk about the first time you saw the band.
Well, growing up in South Carolina, nothing good came through there. The Circle Jerks. the Circle Jerks.
South Carolina visitors and convention bureau, right?
I went to art school in Rhode Island. I was living in Providence. So the first week of my freshman year at art school, 1988, the Ramones with Jane's Addiction opening. Came through and nobody knew Jane's Addiction yet.
Hold on, Ramones with Jane's Addiction opening. I love that.
Yeah. And I had done a year of art high school out here, and so a friend of mine had the Jane's Addiction demo. So I was like, oh yeah, I'll go early and I'll be there. No one was there for Jane's Addiction. There were 20 people up at the stage, but right after they ended, it was a 500 person venue called the Living Room. 1,500 people are all of a sudden slammed in there, and it was so jam packed that I could lift my feet off the ground without pushing down on anything. I thought my rib cage was going to collapse, and I was so excited to see the Ramones. I wasn't going to budge from my spot right at the stage.
Yeah.
So I'd been waiting for got there early and stayed for 3 hours right at the stage, and it was amazing because once they started going, every single person, they were huge in Providence. Everybody loved them in Providence, the Ramones. And everybody knew the words. It's crazy slam dancing, people jumping off the stage. It was mayhem. And I thought, this place is going to like fall apart at the seams.
Yeah.
But it was one of the greatest shows I've ever seen. I saw them several times, but that being my that first taste of it was it was really, really awesome. And that they did not pause between songs, and that every show is like a greatest hits show. You're just like, ooh, that was good. Oh wait, this is man, every single song, And if you like the Ramones, every show is a greatest hits show.
Yeah.
Because there's so much good stuff, and it's there are very few shows that you ever go to that where you're like, okay, all right, I'm gonna go take a pee break right now. I'll come back when there's a better song. You can't do that at a Ramones show.
So Seymour, I want to ask you, your wife co-managed the Ramones
with Danny
for a number of years, and I have to ask because I'm just fascinated by it. What was it like to be in business with the Ramones?
Well, I can't. You really have to. It's a shame Danny can't be here. For me, it was a little uncomfortable because they were in my house all the time, And I had come back from England for a different trip, and the phone rings, and it's Johnny, and he says, "We got some new songs, and we want you to hear them, I said, "Look, it's Sunday. Give me one day. Anytime you want to come in Tuesday." He said, "We know you're not doing anything on Wednesday night, so we booked ourselves into CBGB's, and I checked out who the opening band was going to be, and it was a band I had already seen. And so I was standing outside with Lenny Kaye, and all of a sudden, I hear this, "When My Love Stands Next to..." And it was that's how I first got to hear Talking Heads, and I owe it to them for hearing them, you know, early on, and eventually signing them. And you know they had great taste in bands, you know, the Ramones did. And I owe that to them. So all in all, it worked out just fine.
Right. Well, and one thing, but I'll get to you in one second. So, you know, one of the things, you know, Joey, after the band wound down, he was always a champion
of
other bands, other artists, you know, the new artists. Talk a little bit about
his
enthusiasm for
music. I had a band with the guys in the band are here tonight, called Purple Majesty in 1967. We were 12 years old, and we would rehearse in the basement of our house. And my brother was 16, and he came. We were writing original songs, and he came down and said, "I want to take you guys into the studio and produce a single for you." 16 years old, yeah. You know?
I mean,
and he did it.
Yeah.
He saved his money. I don't know how he got it, but maybe stole it from my mother. Maybe. But he booked the time in Sanders' studio and took us in, and we recorded two songs.
Yeah. Monty, you were going to say something.
Well, talking about Danny not being here, bear with me here.
Something else, I'll get back to
you. Funny story about the New Year's Eve show at the Rainbow.
Yeah.
Johnny was adamant about, he hated British food. Just absolutely hated the food over there. It was always like, curry again, curry, in backstage. So on this particular night, John Reed, who was managing Elton John was at the show, Seymour was there, Linda was there. Yeah. And we were supposed to have a follow-up dinner that evening at John Reed's restaurant.
Yes.
And so we all pop in the limo. I think we had one limo. We were all crushed in one limo, and we ended up being in the middle of Trafalgar Square on New Year's Eve. We were stuck there for like 2 hours, and Johnny was furious, and he wanted his hamburger because John Reed promised him a hamburger, and we're waiting. We're all starving. We did a great show at the Rainbow, and we get stuck in Trafalgar Square for literally 2 hours. We ended up getting John Reed's restaurant like at 1:30 in the morning or something like that. And John greeted us with a kilt on, I remember. And he had a hamburger for Johnny. He did.
Nice.
Johnny got his hamburger.
Nice.
Here's to say, my brother was so consumed with the spirit of rock and roll. He was intent on getting unsigned bands exposure. Started managing some bands. He would have shows where he would, that was the whole purpose.
Sure.
You know?
Sure.
And people would come up to him in CBGB and want to talk to him, and he'd say, shh, you know, and point to the stage, mm-hmm. just so, you know, that they would pay attention
to
the
band. Right, respect to the other bands.
Right.
Yeah.
All
Monty,
right,
go ahead.
So I just got this from Danny, so he'll bear with me, please. Hello, friends and family of the Ramones. I'm sorry I can't be there in Los Angeles for this event, but I did just spend a long and wonderful summer of Ramones in London and Ireland. There were endless tributes to the band, recalling, honoring, praising, and missing the Ramones so much. Their legacy is more enormous than ever in the British Isles, and that was no surprise. Many people came up to me to tell me that they were there in July 4th, 1976, a day that changed their lives, just like the Ramones have done for all of us. Love, Danny.
Yeah, there you go. So Linda, you know, no secret that Johnny and Joey had a difficult relationship. No secret about that.
Really?
Yeah. I'm sure this comes as a shock. However, they set that aside. Because my sense, being an outside observer, that they knew that the music was somehow bigger than the two of them. What was your perspective of that?
Well, the band always came first. It came before all our personal lives. Obviously, when I left Joey and I went with Johnny, that was a whole big problem. And but we all worked it out. And then...
It's amazing how years of complications can be summed up in one simple sentence.
Boom.
We all worked it out. The three of us worked together, you know. And honestly, the band came before our personal life.
Mm.
And even
what else were they
going to
do?
Other,
you know, they you know, quit the remote. What are they going to do? John's going to go back to working a construction job?
Yeah.
You know?
Well,
so they knew that was it.
But I mean, but lesser things have broken up bigger bands. Yes. I mean, there's no
but
question.
But this wasn't going to happen.
But they weren't a bigger band.
You know, and throughout the years, though, as much as Joey and Johnny, oh, they hated each other, Joey did send Johnny a Christmas card every year. Which I actually got to keep one because now I realized Johnny would come home and throw it out before he'd go get home from the mailbox. Huh. But one time I went to the mailbox first. And I know I probably could, I can't go in jail for opening up my husband's envelope, can I? Maybe. I don't know. But I opened up the Christmas card from Joey. I hope not. And it said to John, let's make lots of, and there was dollar signs.
Oh my God.
And party at John's house. And that was the only Christmas card I kept. And I came home, I showed it to Johnny, and I go, Joey sends you a Christmas card every year? He goes, no. And I go, but I have it. That's not his. Uh-huh. And I'm like, it is, it's his handwriting, I know it. And so, as much as they say they hated each other, they stayed in it together from the beginning to the end.
Yeah.
And in the studio as well. There's never animosity in the studio. They were all hardworking all the time. We went in there to work. There was no messing around.
Right.
It was just get in there and work. And that was the commander in chief. You know?
They realized that the music they made and their performance on stage was bigger than fighting and breaking up. Mm-hmm. So they stopped, you know, they didn't talk a lot to each other. It wasn't bad as people make out, you know, not, you know. So they realized, I mean, musicians here in the audience, I was a musician myself, when you go on stage and you're playing and you get that feedback from the audience, it's like a drug. And that's what they like. They like that idea of keeping that together. I mean, how many marriages lasted 20 years?
Yeah.
So, I mean, they had that music and the stage and the live shows, that's what kept them together.
Sure.
So Tommy was helpful in that regard too, wasn't he?
In the beginning,
peaceful.
Yeah. In the beginning.
So, fair warning, we're going to ask for a couple of questions from the esteemed audience here. But before we get there, so I think everyone up here has had the chance to kind of walk through the exhibit a little bit, either here or at the Queen's Museum. And I'm wondering, as you go through it, is there something that, you know, something that surprises you about the band, a memory that surprises you? Is there something that is, you know, that perhaps you didn't remember in the process?
No.
I thought that was a really good question.
Seeing it all together like that, it has a much different impact.
How so?
Well, you see the mass of artwork and
overwhelming.
You know, the posters of all the shows. Yeah. And You've never seen it before all put together like
sure.
that.
Sure.
So it's awesome.
I just have to say, I remember you. I remember that.
Now I see why you didn't have a career in rock and roll.
I just played bass. I didn't sing.
I knew this was going to devolve here in a minute. Yeah.
And I would never have thought that when I... Because the first time I heard the Ramones, I never got to answer that question. It was in the studio.
Yeah,
that was. I didn't see them live. I was living in Canada. I had heard a little bit. Read Roxy, Lisa's magazine, and I read about them, but I didn't hear them. So the first time I heard them, I was stuck up there. I was listening to Shom FM. You know, it was like Peter Frampton and Fleetwood Mac and the Eagles, and you know. And then I come back into the studio and hear this wall of sound, this grandiose, beautiful music coming out, and I was floored. It was just amazing. And I would have never thought that one day that we would have an exhibit in the Queen's exhibit, that the records would be going gold, that all these people that who are fans, that you see Ramone shirts all over the place. It's thrilling to have been involved, and I'm proud to have been involved.
And a couple of months ago, the record came back on the Billboard charts.
Yeah.
Amazing.
38 years to go gold on the first album.
Yeah.
So... This is a very good looking group here.
Timing.
Do we have a question or two from the house? Yes, sir, right here.
What were some of the bands that the Ramones were really influenced by, that they were really excited about?
Who were they listening to?
The Ohio Express. And
Alice Cooper.
Slade.
Stooges. Slade. We love Slade.
Yeah.
Slade.
T-Rex.
MC5. Stooges.
Come on, feel the noise.
Iggy.
The Stooges, yeah.
Spox.
Yeah. Bay City Rollers.
That's pretty good.
Yeah. They got the chant from
Saturday night.
Yeah, Saturday night. The Bay City Rollers.
The chant for Hey Ho.
I love all this. Who's got another question?
S-A-T-U-R-D-A-Y.
This is an incredibly reticent crowd for a Ramones show. Well, let me ask this. So, you know, remarkable exhibit, right on the other side of the wall here. Can you give me a sense of what the Ramones' legacy should be in your mind? What do you think their legacy
is? I mean, the legacy. I mean, I think that. 100 years from now, that's one of the bands people will remember because they were so unique, so different. You know, I mean, look, they never sold the kind of records that the Rolling Stones or the Beatles, but they're a truly unique group, and their fans were like no other fans. So I think there's, you know, enough of them that it will carry on and on and on and on. That's what I believe, honestly.
Yeah.
I think you can do it too is really the
five true enough
words. Keep it short.
Sure, absolutely.
The coolest Linda. Band ever.
That works.
Yeah, they had an integrity that'll live on forever.
Integrity, yeah. Mm-hmm. What about you, Ed? What do you think?
You know, as Legs McNeil said in the End of the Century film, they were the Pied Pipers of rock and roll. Uh-huh. They would play in a town somewhere in the middle of the Midwest, and the next day, there would be like 10 new bands inspired by the Ramones.
Yeah, I kind of look at the little Johnny Appleseed.
Monty, go ahead.
Right? Well, more like the Johnny Appleseeds of rock. They'd plant their seeds. Yes. All these, they would play all these little towns and overseas, and all these kids would come and see them, and they start all these bands. And all of a sudden, years later, Metallica comes up to them and says, "Hey, we love you. Bono, you too. Mm-hmm. Rob Zombie. All these groups love them.
Yeah.
Soundgarden, Rancid." But, you know, it's incredible, all these people that were influenced by the Ramones. They were young kids that saw them. And they were influenced.
Yeah, it's amazing how many artists that we have on this very stage, we do these programs all the time, who bring up these guys as being so influential and instrumental in so many careers, and not just, you know, necessarily loud, fast rock and roll, but the ethos of who they were as people and artists. So I'm gonna give the last word to Linda, because I believe you have something special to say.
Oh, yes, we have a very little special event coming right up right now with one of the most legendary punk rockers, Mr. Steve Jones.
Yeah.
Jonesy Jukebox, KLOS.
And
the most handsome guy in punk rock, and actually Johnny Ramone said that, Mr. Billy Idol.
So we got a special, we're gonna set up here for a special performance with Steve Jones and Billy Idol. So give us a couple of minutes and we'll do something cool here. First of all, round of applause, Monty Melnick, Ed Stasium, Mickey Leigh, Seymour Stein, Shepard Fairey, Linda Ramone, Billy Idol. Give it up.
Thank you all.
Thank you.